Okay, hi everyone. My name is Leandro Ariza. Today I'm going to present you this work, Shaded Nearest Neighbor Graph and Entropy-Based Features for Representing and Clustering Real-World Data. This presentation is based on in a chapter on my doctoral thesis that I'm writing down right now. I'm expecting to finish in this chapter maybe this month, on the first 2 weeks of the next month. It's still under construction, so I expected some question about, and you can help me to improve this. Okay, this is our line. We have a short introduction. We are going to talk about the last thing that I present you last year, a previous proposed method. I'm going to give you some background. I'm going to present this new second proposed method. I'm going to show you some experiments and results, and we are going to give you some concluding remarks. So, right now, my thesis is related to unsupervised learning methods and that we can use to learn the data's inner structure. Maybe the most widely known method of this kind is the clustering methods. And this kind of methods and another ones that fall in this category, in a conventional way, make some assumptions about data distribution. Most of the time, they assume the data had a normal distribution, for example. And on the other hand, we have the graphs, that is the mathematical tool that I'm using in my thesis. It's focusing on the use of graph to allow the extraction of useful information from the data. And right now, we are going to focus it in some particular kind of graph, the shaded neighbor similarity graphs, based on which we can obtain shared neighbor similarity measures that in the past has been reported as a method able to perform better in comparison, for example, with the Euclidean distance in the measuring of distance in high dimensional space. Okay, I'm going to present you the last method that I propose. This one is maybe the second or third chapter of my thesis. All this previous proposed method has been already reported. Last year, I present this work in a conference in Mexico, Latin American Congress of Biomedical Engineering, because we use this method, we apply this method in the analysis of biological data. So this is a short presentation about that. As I told you before, my work is focused on high dimension and multidimensional data. We have observations. Imagine that we had a matrix. So the rows are of the observation and the columns are the features of that observations. Observation can be, for example, signals, electrical signals, for example, genome sequences, and another kind of observation. In this case, we have a two-dimensional space. Our data is in a two-dimensional space. It's in this case, it's integrated data, but you can assume that this, for example, is the height of the person and this is the weight, whatever you want. Okay? In this world, we are focused on finding the clusters or data points that are around this two-dimensional space. So our method begins with measuring data similarity. And then perform some entropy measures. Then we are going to perform a data sampling process that is based on the entropy measures. And this process is performed in a theory weight. Next, we are going to build a graph, in this case, a fusion connectivity graph, in order to obtain a layout that describes the distribution of data points. And then we are going to apply some clustering method, in this case, one based on graph. This is the so-called Louvain method that is popular in the community detections. And then based on some clustering that we perform on the connectivity graph, we are going to use that clustering to obtain a final clustering for all the data points. Okay. Then we are going to the data similarity that we perform is based on this Gaussian function. In particular, we previously compute the pairwise distance between all the data points, and then we calculate this parameter, compute this parameter that is popular in the supervising learning literature. So then we convert this transform this distance in similarities using this Gaussian function. And based on the similarity, in those similarities, we obtain a compute entropy based the Shannon entropy based on the binary entropy function that is proposed also in the literature. And then for every data point, we perform this sum. Okay, in that way, as you can see, all the data points in the core of every cluster has a higher entropy. Entropies, darker entropies. Excuse me. It's in the opposite way. Darker data points are more entropic. So, less entropy data points is in the inner core, and more entropic are in the boundaries, the groups. In this way, we are able to characterize every data point, so we can differentiate the data points in the core of the clusters, and we can use, for example, this information to looking for the more density clusters, for example, or we can use that information to identify potential cluster centers. We can, for example, apply a threshold around some value, high value, and then we can identify these data points. Okay, then we are use this information to sampling the data set. The first time we are looking for the less entropy data point in this case, and we, for example, discard some values around this data point, the same sample points. That this means that these points are discarded. So the next sample is the less entropy data point. Once we discard the original data point and the other ones, at the end we obtain something like this. This is the outcome of the iterative entropy-based data sampling process. All these are the samples. As you can see, we have in the core of every cluster, we have these potential centers. And based on this data point, we are going to obtain a fuzzy connectivity graph. In this kind, we use all these data points, these samples, as the center of a fuzzy clustering. And then we measure how every fuzzy cluster having these points at centers overlap each other. So where you see these thicker edges is because the overlapping is high enough. And in these places, there is no much overlapping. And there are places there where there is no overlap, for example. Then we are in this, over this graph, we run the Luben method. That is a clustering algorithm on graph. As you can see, we have all these communities in the network analysis field. Communities are a group of nodes that are well connected between them and have less connection with the outside of the community. So as you can see, all these points are well connected between them, among them. And there are a few connections outside the community. In this case, there are two connections to outside the community, and in this we have only one. And again, we have three of them. But in general, there are more connections inside the cluster than outside the cluster, leaving the cluster. And then we use this clustering, we propagate this clustering of, to all the remaining data points. So this is the final clustering. This was our previous method. I'm giving you this as a context because some of you were in here the last semester, so that maybe you can know, you even don't know what I'm talking about. Okay. Now I'm going to give you some background about this k-nearest neighbor graph that we are going to use in order to improve this previous method. We use this kind of graph in order to model the local neighborhood, the relationship among data points. We had a data set, and for every data point in that data set, we discover what is the set of the neighbors, or the k-nearest neighbors, using some kind of distance measure, probably the Euclidean distance. So for every data point, we had a subset of, in this case, of k data points. Then we use this information to build a graph. In this case, this is the representation of the graph, for example, an adjacent matrix. In this case, we connect two data points. It is shared, and if it's, I have two data points, the I and J, and we are going to connect them in two cases. For example, if one of them is a neighbor of another one, this is the case of the OR. Or maybe we can be more strict in this case, and only connect them if the J is in the neighborhood of I and I is in the neighborhood of J. So we can change OR for AND. In this case, that graph is called mutual k nearest neighbor graph. Based on this way of connecting the data points, we obtain this graph. This is the representation of a graph, the vertex set and the edges set. So as a sample, we have this. This is a toy data set, a two-dimensional data set. And using, for example, in k equal to 5, obtain this kind of k-nearest neighbor. For this one, is based on the previous definition. This is not a mutual k-n graph. In this case, every data point is at least connected to 5 neighbors. So as you can see, we are able to model, describe the inner structure of the data set. We can see maybe trees, groups of data points that are not the conventional cluster, the globular clusters. So we have this group, and this second one, and this third one, and based on this model, graph model, we obtain this representation. So then we are going to talk about the shared neighbor graph. This is the is is It's basically a mutual kinetics graph that had weights on the edges. So for every data point, we obtain this subset where we have, for example, this is the set of data points that two data points, the set of neighbors that two different data points share. So as you can see, this is the neighborhood of this one. And in this case, an edge that belongs to this set is because this is the neighbor of this point and this one at the same time. Based on this set of data points, we can obtain some kind of distance. This is not strictly a distance. It's because it's, there is one of the properties that doesn't fulfill. Okay, thank you. And I already made the proofs. So they are going to
like a pseudo metric.
This is a pseudo metric. And this proof is going to stay in the some, not last chapter, and the next chapter of the thesis maybe. And then we based on this distance, we compute a weight function. So every edge is going to have a weight. In this way, we compare a mutual k-nearest graph in a shared network graph. Let me show you something. We have this toy data set. As you can see there, these are two clusters, different clusters of points. We are building there at a three nearest neighbor graph. This one has arrows in each edge, because this is the k nearest neighbor graph that isn't a directed graph. As you can see, for example, about this data point, these are the neighbors. This one, and this one, and this one. Look at the points, the arrows, the edges. But in this case, for example, this one are mutual neighbors, for example, in this case. So then we are going to look for the edges that have two arrows in the end points. That edges are the edges that we will keep in this construct, in this mutual nearest neighbor graph. So we forget about this edge and this one and those. So, and then we are going to weight every edge based on the amount number of shared neighbors. So in this place we had, for example, the lowest weight, one. And in this case, as you can see, we had the highest one, for example. Okay. In this new proposed method, we are going to follow the same steps of the previous method. And we are going to measure the data similarity and entropy based on the previous concept that I showed you. So we were there in this point, and then we are going to measure the similarity of the data points, but over a graph. In the previous method, we are measure the similarity without this structure, but we are going to measure the similarity among the data points over a graph in this case. So this is the same Gaussian function. In this case, this alpha hat is computed based not in a average as the previous method. In this case, we are going to use the median function. And then we are going to, for every data point, we are going to compute a entropy, the binary entropy, using the binary entropy function or every data point. So we are converting this the head weights into some kind of entropy features, entropy-based features. But in this case, this particular summatory has a meaning in the in graph theory. This is called the node strength in this case. So I was glad enough to achieve this. Something that I was proposing, we can look for a place where this kind of concept fall in the graph theory. So this is maybe it's a personal victory. So we was in this step in the two previous slides. So we convert that weight into another weight. Using this second wave function, we convert similarities into entropy-based features, entropy measures, and then for every data point we perform that summatory. So we have this, all these data points that were connected has a high entropy. Remember that in the previous slide, we say that darker points are the more entropic. So these are the more entropic ones. And in this case, these are the less entropic, for example. So we already incorporate that concept of shared neighbors graph in the first step. So in this, now we are going to perform the second step, the iterative sampling process based on these new concepts. So we perform these experiments over different real world data sets that are available in the literature. There are, for example, this is the IRIS dataset. It's a dataset with 150 observation. All these observations are measures about morphological measures over flowers of the iris species. We have four dimensions in this case. What you are seeing there, is a two-dimensional embedding that we obtain not using the PCA method, principal component analysis. We are using a more advanced embedding method, the t-stochastic neighbor embedding method. So this is a two-dimensional representation of this four-dimensional data set. So what we did was performing, measure the similarity of the data points in the four-dimensional space, the original space. And then measure the entropy based on obtaining the entropy based features using based on the shared neighbor concept, and then perform the data sampling process. And we are showing you here where these data samples are located on the two-dimensional embedding. This is the previous method. The previous method, for example, was using a parameter called gamma, but this particular detail you can read about that in the publication, the conference paper, and this is the in this case we use 23 nearest neighbors in order to obtain in this case 16 samples. And in the using the previous method, we adjust this parameter in order to obtain the same amount of samples. In this case, maybe the two sets of samples are similar in their distribution, but once we increment the amount of dimensions, the sample improves. This is, for example, the thyroid dataset. that have maybe 2,200 data points and 5 dimensions, for example. This is the two-dimensional embedding using the method, and with the previous method, the samples, this was the distribution, but using this new method, the distribution improves. Because we don't have the power of C on 5 dimensions, we embed the data on 2 dimensions, and we are looking for the places where the samples fall in the two-dimensional embedding. So we are using this two-dimensional embedding as a proxy to know where is located the sample. In this case, the gamma is still 1, and in this case, we only have to use 9 nearest neighbors. And this is the best that I can achieve in order to have the same, maybe the same number of samples, 48 and 45. But as you can see, this sampling process is better than this one. And we are only have one dimensional, and we are only increase the dimension in one comparing with the last example. In this case, for example, we have 7 dimensions, and this is a bigger data set, the E. coli data set. All these data sets are popular on cluster methods. You can find them in Google. In this case, for example, the same gamma, we had to increase the nearest neighbor and maybe obtain almost the same number of samples, but again, this samples process is better than this one. We are trying to improve the sample process in order to obtain a better fuzzy connectivity graph that model the data set. Okay, this is the last one of the samples. So you can see that you had a better sampling process. So again, this is all the steps, and I'm going to show you some results on a toy data set. This is a synthetic data set. I don't remember if it's the same as the first one I showed you. I forget that. So this is the data set. In this case, we compute the entropies of the data point. In this case, the color scale is inverted in comparison with the previous method, but that is because for every data point, we are using less elements in the sumatory, and that causes that the color scale inverted, but it is the same. We have the same feature. The data points in the core of every cluster has a different entropy-based feature than the data points in the boundaries. And then we perform the same sampling process. All these are the samples, for example. And then we obtain a fuzzy connectivity graph. This process is the same than the previous method. And then we perform the Lewain method in order to cluster this graph. And then we propagate this clustering over the graph on the original data set. There are some things that we can improve. For example, establish rules that make that these data points doesn't have the cluster identity. For example, that this group is better that use this identity because they are close to the node cluster. But these are less technical details. So on the experiment, we are still making experiments in this kind of data set, biological data set. The first one, they are a metagenomic data sets, and this one, neurological signals It's a data set of neurological signals. This one, for example, is a data set. There are several of them. In this case, for example, the observation are genomic sequence, and we have, in this case, for example, that there are 5 or 10 different groups of genomes fragments. This is a mixture of genome coming from so 5 or maybe 10 species of microorganisms, and the features in this case are genomic features. And in this case, for example, this is the block where we obtain the features. And the number of features that we obtain here in this case are near to 500 features. In every case, we try to reduce the amount of features to obtain a second data set. So this is we are processing a high dimensional space, and in this way we are processing a low dimensional space. In this case, at the end we are going to separate the fragments. The fragments are called contigs in that scenario. In this case, all the contigs of fragments are separated in different groups, and they call in the metagenomic field, they call the groups beans. So in this case, we have bean contigs. And in this example, these are electrical spikes of the neurons from the brain. So we have different data sets that have 5 different kind of spikes, or maybe 20 different kind of spikes. And the features are obtained based on the wavelet, the hard wavelet. We are using the coefficients, because these signals are 64 length. So we, in this case, has in the high dimensional space, we had 64 features, or we can obtain a subset using another method. At the end, using or the proposed method, we are sorted the spikes. So we are separate the spikes in different groups, depending on a spike comes from a neuron or a different neuron. So this is the results. In the case of the metagenomic divining, we call the indirect approach the process or perform the clustering on the low dimensional space, that in this case is a three-dimensional space. All the data points lodging in the first place in a 500 data space were embedded in a three-dimensional space in this case. And this is the clustering performed in the original data space. And the different colors, this is a reference method in the low dimensional spaces, or reference method is another word that we present that the professor Nicolas Perez presented in this year in a IEEE conference. So we are in this case we are comparing with a previous work, see, and we have the previous proposed method that we present in Mexico, and this one is the method that I was exposing here. So as you can see in the low dimensional spaces, there is no motion, all the three methods perform in similar way. There is no significant difference in the results, but I forget to put that all the elements that describe that the significance. In the high dimensional space, I forget to tell you something about. This is our clustering see, there are cluster indices that measure the quality of the clustering. In this case, this is the F score, this is the AMI score, and the adjusted RAN index, for example. This is pretty popular, this one. So higher is better. This all these scores goes from 0 to 1, and 1 is perfect in this case. So in this scenario, as you can see, the second proposed method has an increment in the performance. And obviously, you achieve better results in high dimensional space. In a low dimensional space. In this case, we have a lot of dimension, but even with that amount of dimension, the second proposed method performs better in comparison with methods used in there. And this slide I present you, for example, the amount of the errors that we obtain when the every method try to figure out the number of clusters. So in both cases, our proposed method, the second one, has a estimate better the number of clusters per data set. And the previous method has a high rate of errors. And this one, for example, is okay. Excuse. That title is wrong. In that case, it's metagenomic binning. That's the scenario of spy sorting. So this is the process applied of this electrical signal from the brain. This is the in this scenario we call subset at when we are trying to cluster all the data points based on a subset of features. This subset of features were obtained using this software that is in a state of the art software to perform the spy cluster the spy sorting. And this is the most recent version of this software. And in this case, we have all the features. In this scenario, we don't have a reference method in particular. So in this case, we can see how the second proposed method has a higher performance in comparison with the reference method and proposed method. And in the full scenario where you have all the features in the same way, we have better performance. And as before, the amount of errors are regarded to the process of estimating the correct number of clusters. In this case, we reduce the errors when we use this method, when you use the method based on the shared nearest neighbors concept. To finish this presentation, we have, for example, all these ideas come from different worlds. In the case, for example, the world of Yao et al. Is where it's introducing how to measure the entropy of data points based on the summatory. And for example, the world of Lascaris or Sanfeiru is where they propose the fusion connectivity graph. And in this another world where it's proposed how to measure the similarity between data points using shared nearest neighbor measures. So we stand over that pillars and go further and propose this work. And here, for example, we have how the incorporation of the shared nearest neighbor graph and the measures, distance measure or similarity measure based on this concept. What is the impact of this incorporation of the on our work we are able to compute the entropy Bayesian feature using graph theory concepts, in this case the strand on a node. As you can see, we improve the sampling process. We was able to reduce the amount of errors when it comes to estimate the number of clusters, and of course we improve the detection of the inner structure, see, of the data set in this biological application, which are related to unsupervised learning methods, because when you are obtaining, we are performing the clustering of the signals, you doesn't already know how many spikes are firing there, but these are controlled scenarios. Okay. As future work, we have to study and exploit the properties of this entropy-based graph that we are obtaining, maybe in order to improve the clustering process. We also could incorporate these node attributes, for example, the entropy of every, because right now we are not using the entropy of each 8 data point to influence the clustering process. So we can use that features for that. And that's all. Thank you for listening to me.